Thank you, Billy. Good morning, Naples Community Church family. How's everyone? Beautiful morning. We have a little wind and weather coming up, don't we? So, hope everyone's preparing and, you know, we'd not be fearful. We're a child of God, right? We just prepare. If anyone needs help at all, please call Tom and I, if you would. First and foremost, let's turn off our cell phones. Thank you. We have so much going on. It's the end of September, so we have our birthday celebration for our September babies. So we have cake in the back and, of course, a special song by Billy at the end. So stay till the end. You'll get all the fun. We have our flowers today, courtesy of Bonnie Ruling and Friends, in honor of Julie Becker's mother's passing. And Julie would like each of you ladies to grab a flower at the end of the service. She would love to gift that to you, so please do that. We've got Sunday prayer, as always. If you get here early, 9:30-ish before, Dawn's hosting that upstairs. So if you feel like you got a big hug from the Holy Spirit when you walked in, that's what did happen, because everyone, you're prayed for and you're protected. So speaking of hugs, hope everyone shared some love this morning. We're so grateful that you're all here. There's nothing like being here in person. Of course, our online, we hope you're doing well. We thank you for tuning in. Tom and I tuned in from Montana last week with a bunch of friends. It was so great to see you all. I love when Dustin pans the room. We're like, oh, there's everybody. Super fun for us. So it's thank you, Dustin, because it's really fun to live stream when you do have to. Bible study on Monday with Dawn as well, noon for everybody and 6 p.m. for the ladies. You can Zoom in, you can come to the Sunshine Room, whatever is best for you, and look for those links when we have anything at the church. Look for those links on the website or on the email. Again, with the wind and weather, we are postponing the issues hour on Wednesday. There'll be nothing going on Wednesday this week. And we have community prayer 12 to 1, of course, everything permitting. But if you want to get your bucket filled with some love and prayer and also help fill somebody else's, I'll tell you, there's nothing like that Friday 12 to 1 prayer. It's lovely. Let's see, October. Can you believe it's October starting Saturday? We've got signups in the back, as always. Ladies' lunch is resuming October 18th. We're meeting at Two Fillets on Tuesday, October 18th. Please join individual checks. And speaking of ladies' luncheons, we had that first annual F3 anniversary dinner on Thursday, and it was amazing. There were so many ladies there. It says a lot to the ladies who run that, and I'll tell you, it was a lovely event, and Virginia and Luane did a fantastic job of hosting that. In October, on the 12th, Wednesday the 12th, is movie night. We're resuming that. And that's going to be at the Paragon Theater. We're going to be watching, it's a true account produced by Ron Howard called 13 Lives. It's really amazing, and you need to be there. So please come join us for fellowship and a great movie. Let's see what else. On Saturday, the 1st, I don't think we have sign-ups yet. I don't even know if Dustin has a PDF on that, a slide, but 11 o'clock this Saturday. Please be here to celebrate the life of Dan Bruce, Air Force, career, military, Liz Johnson's love. He passed, and we're going to be celebrating that this Saturday. So please come, and it's going to be a memorable time for you. Mary Rush wanted to make sure that you know that we have an addendum and corrections and updates for our member directory. So please pick those up. I think they're on both tables. All right. We love you. Open your hearts to what Pastor Kurt has to say and just enjoy. Enjoy today. Yes, Kathy.
I have to announce this because we've been wanting to, but for those of you that weren't at the lunch, the F3 is sponsoring the cottage at the women's shelter. And this last year, where we are furnishing it with a variety of furnishings.
things. We have a list in the back of the church. Anyone can donate. So please go back to the back of the church if you're inclined. I'll make a donation and bring it in by October 17th. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy. Yes, and men and women can donate to that. And we'll take checks and whatever you sign up for. It's just very easy, and it'll really bring some love to that group. Thank you, Kathy, and thank you, F3.
And there's more that rises in the morning than the sun, and more that shines in the night than just the moon. It's more than just this fire here that keeps me warm, in a shelter that is larger than this room. And there's a loyalty that's deeper than mere sentiments, and the music higher than the songs that I can sing. The stuff of earth competes for the allegiance I owe only to the giver of all good things. So if I stand, let me stand on the promise that you will pull me through. And if I can, let me fall on the grace that first brought me to you. And if I sing, let me sing for the joy that is born in me these songs. And if I weep, let it be as a man who is longing for his home. And there's more that dances on the prairies than the wind, and more that pulses in the ocean than the tide. There's a love that is fiercer than the love between friends, more gentle than a mother's when the baby's at her side. And there's a loyalty that's deeper than mere sentiments, and the music higher than the songs that I can sing. The stuff of earth competes for the allegiance I owe only to the giver of all good things. So if I stand, let me stand on the promise that you will pull me through. And if I can't, let me fall on the grace first brought me to you. And if I sing, let me sing for the joy that is born in me these songs. And if I weep, let it be as a man who is longing for his home. And if I stand, let me stand on the promise you will pull me through. And if I can't, let me fall on the grace that first brought me to you. And if I sing, let me sing for the joy that is born in me these songs. And if I weep, let it be as a man who is longing for his home. And if I weep, let it be as a man who is longing for his home.
Richard Mullins, will you please stand for our opening song? New one for us here at NCC.
Jesus said that if I thirst, I should come to him. No one else can satisfy. I should come to him. Jesus said if I am weak, I should come to him. Should come.
Father, it is just so incredible to be able to meet in the presence of the Most High God, the creator of the universe, who is the Lion of Judah and the Lamb that was slain, the refiner's soap in the fire, and yet the Rose of Sharon. Strong and kind are probably the only words that I can even fathom, but yet you are so multifaceted. You are love and merciful and generous beyond anything. And you know every hair that is on our heads. You know every single sorrow we have. You know every single pain we have. You know every single euphoric, wonderful emotion that we have. You know what scares us. You know what we need you. And I thank you for meeting each one of us where we are. I want to thank you for my NCC family who have chosen to be here. I want to pray for those that couldn't be here, whether they are online or at some other congregation. Father, I pray for all of the congregations that are lifting up your son's name. Father, that your Holy Spirit would be so felt and you would be speaking to each one of us through your servants, through the preaching of the word, through song, through a million other different ways that you could get our attention for the uniqueness of each one of us. I do ask, Father, that your Holy Spirit would be very present here. I pray, Father, that we will not be the same when we leave this building as we were when we came here. I pray we will be better equipped to face what goes on this next week by being here in assembly together under the banner of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. And for that, I am eternally, eternally grateful. May you have your way here in everything that is done, said, and acted upon. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Day I fall on my knees. 'cause your grace still amazes me. Your grace still amazes me.
So good to have Julianne back, and thank you, Julianne. And I have to say, I did go to this F3 thing this week, and all I can say is that what happens at F3 stays at F3, so a lot of chaos, a lot of fun, hard laughter, and it was really a good thing for me to get out of there. So we've got a hurricane coming, and I hate to do this. I hate to buckle to a hurricane, but you know, it's, you know, the discretion, they say, is the better part of valor, but it's also the better part of cowardice. And so, because I know some of you would drive through 45 mile an hour winds to get here for the Issues Hour, I thought I would go ahead and cancel. But also, this building is a phenomenal building, and it's the glass is like a half inch thick. We went through Irma we lost some tiles off the roof, but that was it. No real incursions of water. If it comes close, please contact us here in the office. We'll talk about I'll try to get authority to open up our building as a sanctuary, as a safe place for you to weather the storm, especially those of you who are close by. So just, I wanted to just let you know that. And I have no authority to do this, but I should be able to get it from our board members. And again, this has been safe. If water comes in here, we've got upstairs, so we're fine. And as we go to prayer, I'm just caught up for words sometimes, because I know the personal struggles that people have, and I almost can't even talk about it or even enter into it without kind of myself falling into that place of their struggle. But I did want to call attention to a few items. First off, we have a service on Saturday for Dan Bruce, a fighter in Vietnam and a jet fighter, and more on that during the service. A remarkable man, and his sweetheart Liz has faithfully followed up with us to make sure that we have a service for him. And so that's on Saturday if you can be here. We did have Steve Klostrom on our list for last week, and they were driving to the hospital and they got called off for some stupid paperwork, but he will have his back surgery tomorrow. So Steve asks for your prayers. And Nikki is facing hip surgery and possibly knee surgery coming up. And so this is a tough time for Nikki Norman. And so we please know of our prayers, and we want to uphold you through that. And it just seems that we always have an awful lot to pray for once we pause and once we really reflect on each other's lives and all that stands before us and all that besets us. And we have a number of people that we are praying for on a regular basis. And so let's just bow together. Oh, gracious Father, as we simply think on or recall or have awareness of the needs of others who are around us, Lord God, when those awarenesses, when those thoughts come to us, you're prompting us, you're reminding us, you're telling us that we need to pray. We know, Lord, you don't need to hear it, but we do need to say it. We need to be recalling and remembering our brothers and sisters in prayer and for this world for which you died, to pray for it. And so, Lord, we ask that we might respond graciously when, in the midst of our days, a name comes to us, when you prompt us in ways that we're not even aware what the trigger may be, but there's something that comes to us and you call us to pray. So Father, with the names that we have on our list, we know that these are more than just names. And Lord, I thank you that we're a church that has a blessed intimacy, that we actually know each other, and we can bear one another's burdens. Thank you, O Lord, that we can see each other face to face, or we can know one another in a manner that upholds each other. Even as we do, O Lord, we can likewise do so with fun and laughter, for so often it's the case that we are pulled out of a pit of despair simply because somebody has offered us some warmth or affection, a word of acknowledgement, a cup of coffee or a cookie. Dear Father, in these ways you minister to us. Our hands become your hands. And so, Lord, I pray that you would make us a people of prayer, a people that will offer their intercessions on behalf of one another. And Lord, no matter how deep a brother or sister among us might feel that they have descended, may they know they are not alone. They're not alone, that we're there for them. And Father, we also ask that others who are not a part of our church, whom we love and whom we care for, may likewise know that the love that we have for them is your love through us. May they know that they're loved with an everlasting love, even though they may not darken these doors. Lord, your love goes out to all. We're reminded that your Son came and died for the world. And so, Lord, as many as might come in, Lord, we work toward that end. We continue to pray, Lord, for our nation. We pray for those people who have been affected by this storm and those who will be affected. And we pray, O Lord, that in such times as this, we would be reminded that it is your voice that can still the storm. Your voice can still the waters. Your voice can open the skies and cause the sun to shine. Remind us, O Lord, that you are sovereign over all. You didn't just create the universe and set it spinning. You created the universe and sent yourself loving. So we're reminded that none of these things happen outside of your oversight and providence and care. And so we ask your comfort upon all who might be affected over these next several days. And Lord, we also ask that we might deepen in our care for one another, our kindness, and our strength. Make us, like your Son, strong and kind. We pray even as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. When we bring our offering, we don't do it because God needs it. We do it because we need it. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. And so when we give of ourselves, it's because we are ennobled in doing so. And so we give to God our tithes and offerings. Thank you. And now, dear Father, give us an uncommon strength, not as the world gives, but as you alone give. May we submit ourselves to your word with joy and anticipation. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our psalm this morning, I'm actually going to end at verse 11 rather than 13 as it's been published, but it's a psalm that is based on an acrostic of the Hebrew alphabet. So it's following the letters of Hebrew, of the Hebrew alphabet, and this happens more than once. 139th psalm is the longest psalm, and it's likewise an acrostic. And so it becomes sort of a string of pearls, one after another. It's a little proverb with each one. And yet this psalm repeats a recurrent theme, and that is trusting in God. Hear the word of God as it comes to us from the 37th psalm and then from Matthew 5. Fret not yourself because of the wicked, be not envious of wrongdoers, for they will soon fade like the grass and wither like the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good so that you will dwell in the land and enjoy security. Take delight in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord, trust in him and he will act. He will bring forth your vindication as the light and your right as the noonday. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not yourself over him who prospers in his way, over the man who carries out evil devices. Refrain from anger. Forsake wrath. Fret not yourself, it tends only to evil. For the wicked shall be cut off, but those who wait for the Lord shall possess the land. Yet a little while, and the wicked will be no more. Though you look well at his place, he will not be there. But the meek shall inherit the earth and delight themselves in abundant prosperity. And then our Lord from his Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. God add his understanding to this hearing of his word. This is one of those beatitudes that I've always had trouble with. You know, the people that I've known that I would call meek are sort of shrinking violets. They're sort of the shy guy in the corner. And this one never made much sense to me. But somehow, I'm nevertheless sort of captured by this contrast of meekness and strength. It's sort of like something that captures our imagination before our reason can dismiss it. Where we're given a story, we're given an account, we're told something, and it captures our imagination, and yet it takes a while for us to sort of explain it away, set it aside as just a myth. I was finishing up a summer at summer camp up in Northern California, and one of the guys on the work crew that I was working with said to me, scientists looking into the skies, looking into the heavens, have seen the New Jerusalem out there in heaven descending to the earth. And I thought, oh, really? And I tried to find any accounts to this. I tried to find something to explain this, to describe what was going on. And so my reason, after a while, dismissed it as silliness. But it it captured me nevertheless. My imagination got captured by that image. And we don't know if it's true. I kind of doubt it, but I mean, it is such that we find ourselves in those times when something captures our imagination and yet reason doesn't seem to appropriate it. But nevertheless, we hold those two in some tension. We hold them in a dynamic tension where they're kind of talking every now and then back and forth with each other. And, you know, we live in a time where there's been a lot of apocalyptic speculations. And the latest has come out just this past week, because Putin says he's going to recruit 300,000 reservists to fight in Ukraine. And Newsweek reports that there's a portion of this that has been excluded or hidden, in which he says he's going to recruit a million to fight in Ukraine. Well, the apocalyptic speculation rushes to the 9th chapter of Revelation, where it says there'll be a 2 million man army that will descend at the battle of Armageddon. And so, again, our imagination gets captured. And then we can't muster enough reason to dismiss it, but we wonder, we doubt it. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. How does that work? If we've been to those leadership seminars and sales seminars and all of that, what we sort of have learned is that it's not the meek that inherit the earth, it's the strong. Those who fight for their position, those who, if necessary, elbow others out of the way, or at least those who work really hard and achieve a lot, they're the ones that inherit the earth. Not the meek. Or is it the meek? What is it we're really talking about? Oftentimes, meekness is associated with that image that I've been talking about. Meekness has been associated with a humility. I'm not important enough, I'm not this, I'm not that. Someone who would recede from everything and anything. And yet that's kind of the understanding of meekness that is not being spoken of here, because Jesus is spoken of as meek. Moses was spoken of as meek. And in this psalm, the meek will inherit the earth, and in the Beatitude, that's doubled down by Jesus. So what really are we talking about? Wild stallions were brought down from the mountains and broken for riding. This is in the Greek world. And if you were in the ancient world, you knew horses. And you knew what was a good horse, what was an old horse, what was a wild horse, what was a tame horse. Wild horses were brought down for riding. Some were used to pull wagons, some were raced, and the best were trained for warfare. They retained their fierce spirit, courage, and power, but were disciplined to respond to the slightest nudge or pressure of the rider's leg. They could gallop into battle at 35 miles per hour and come to a sliding stop at a word. They were not frightened by arrows, spears, or torches. They were said to be praus, meek. That strong horse full of spirit and yet obedient was meek. Strength under control. Strength and spirit and drive and courage, and yet responsive to its rider. To be meek was to be taken from a state of wild rebellion and made completely loyal to and dependent upon one's master. Meek, to be dependent upon one's master, and yet to have all that strength, to have all that drive, to have all that capability, to have all that even rebelliousness, but to have it under control. It's a different understanding of meek. I had a professor in seminary who shared that concept, and all of a sudden that whole world opened up to me. And what it means, of course, is that strength under control entails a courage and a drive, as well as a responsiveness, a sensitivity to know what is the right thing. What does it mean to do the right thing? And so our Lord has given us this instruction that those who are meek are those who are strong, courageous, brave, and yet sensitive, responsive, and obedient. You know, when I was a kid, we used to sing "Trust and Obey." I don't know if you remember that from Sunday school. "Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey." And yet I got to be sophisticated theologically, and I thought, you know, that's not all that true. Because we live by grace, not by obedience. But, you know, I think I was a far better theologian at 28 years old than I am now. And I've come to a place where, yes, there's something to this, that to trust God and obey God, that there's some, this is the way of real happiness in life. And we could use more of it. This strength and gentleness. You know, in Revelation, there's this grand pronouncement of the Lion of Judah, describing the Lion who is coming to make everything right. And the announcement is concluded about the Lion of Judah, and that which is presented is the Lamb that was slain. What was anticipated is the Lion who is going to come in and rock and sock and do all of this stuff and clean everything out, and yet what is presented to us by John in Revelation is the Lamb who was slain and who bears on his body the marks of crucifixion. And so we have there a picture of meekness, strength, and yet at the same time this willingness to set oneself aside for the sake of that which is right and that which is true and that which is correct, and to be a disciplined, self-discipline so that we operate within those confines. So meekness. And one of the great examples from the Christian church, from the history of the church, was in the second century. Polycarp was the bishop of Smyrna, and he actually was one of the disciples of the Apostle John. John, who wrote Revelation, and sent his letter into Asia Minor. Smyrna was one of the churches that received the letter from Paul, which is the book, pardon me, from John, which is the book of Revelation. And he became as a young man, became a follower of John in his advanced years. John is one of the few disciples that we know of that did not die, that we know of, a martyr's death. And yet Polycarp took on the leadership of the church in the Asian province of Smyrna. But the Roman Empire was not happy with the church, because the church was saying Christ is Lord, and the Roman Empire was insisting that Caesar was Lord, and the Christians just couldn't go along with that. And Polycarp was reinforcing that in his church. And so an edict went out that he was to be arrested and executed. Polycarp was 86 years old. And he found out that this was happening, and he wasn't going to do anything. He didn't leave his home or anything like that until his family just said, "No, get out of here." And so he finally, under pressure from them, went out to a little farmhouse outside of town. And the Roman soldiers found out that he was there, and they went to his home, to this little farmhouse. And when they arrived, he greeted them with a smile, had them come in, he fed them, and he said, "Let me just have one more hour of prayer." And he went and receded to pray, and he ended up praying for 2 hours. And in the meantime, these young soldiers, who were probably the age of his grandkids, began to wonder what they were doing, if they were on a fool's errand. Polycarp came out, and they took him to the arena. And there he faced the man who was in charge of everything and was going to oversee the execution. And he was questioned by the proconsul. And he was asking Polycarp who he was and what he was doing. And Polycarp responded, he says, "Since you pretend not to know who I am and what I am, hear me declare with boldness, I am a Christian. And if you wish to learn more about Christianity, I would be happy to make an appointment for you." And then he was put out in the middle of the arena. And the people were yelling, "Away with the atheists, away with the atheists." The atheists were those who were the Christians. Polycarp smiled and looked at them all and said, "Away with the atheists. Away with the atheists." And then the proconsul said to him, "All you have to do is deny your faith, deny Christ, and you will live." Polycarp simply said, 86 years I have served him, and he has done me no wrong. How can I deny my King who has saved me?" And they took him to the post to which he was to be nailed. And he said, "Save your nails, save those that would make you feel secure. I will stand and bear the fire myself." And they lit the fire. And he was consumed. And he died. Now, what does real strength look like? Does strength look like the sort of power that everyone seems to be wrangling over these days? The amassing of larger armies? The building up of greater armories? Is strength a matter of a position that one holds? Or is strength a matter of who one is? And their relationship to God. It's not even strength in self, it's strength in God, who deploys our strength according to his will. Nero was the Caesar at the time. Pardon me, Domitian. I probably have my Caesars wrong here. This was in the first century now. But if I were to choose who I was going to be like, like the Caesar of Rome, in charge of the largest empire on the planet at that time, or this little bishop in this little county of Smyrna? Where is real strength? And so Jesus tells us, blessed are the meek. They will inherit the earth. They will embody what it means to be a follower of God and carry within their own souls and spirits the strength and the dignity and the sensitivity of Christ himself. Will you join me in prayer? And so, Lord, like those who went before us, the martyrs who sang at their martyrdoms, Polycarp who smiled at his accusers, for the saints who have stood on your behalf, Lord God, may we be numbered among them. And the earth that we might inherit might be that which you have set aside for us, according to your will. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand for our closing hymn, For All the Saints.
For the
or not, I shortened the number of verses to that hymn. But I wanted the saints of the church to be known and remembered and held up as an example to us all, those who were so very meek and so very strong. Likewise is our calling. Go in peace and live by faith. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and in the life everlasting. Amen.
But we are celebrating birthdays afterwards, so you know, as tradition.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Linda, Annette, Sarah, John, Thomas, Mike, Father, Carol, Kathy, Bruce, Michael, Doug, Vera, Hildegard, and Tony. Happy birthday to you.
Please stay around for fellowship in case.